Let us pray. Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy great and thy awesome name. Father, we thank thee for this day, for all the blessings in which thou hast blessed us with, for the very air that we breathe, Father. We know it's because of you, and for that we praise thee. We thank thee for this opportunity that we have to come to thee in prayer as thy children. We're thankful just to be called thy children. We're thankful for the opportunity that we have today to study thy will. We pray that as we go about in this day and every day, that we will put thy will into practice, that we will live it in our lives, and that we will be an example to a lost and dying world. Father, we're thankful for this school and for the work that it does, for thy church the world over, for the salvation that is found in it, for the church that meets here at Forest Hill, for the elders that oversee her and oversee this school, Father. Pray that thou will give them wisdom, that thou will, that they will always make the right decisions to keep her sound in the faith, and that we might continue to do a good work for thee. Father, we're thankful for all the many blessings of this life, for all the gifts in which you bestow upon us. We're thankful most of all for that unspeakable gift, for thy Son, for the fact that he died upon a cross in our stead. Father, we love thee, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Number 383. We'll sing the first and last stanzas.
The reading this morning is Acts 8, 4 and 5. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them.
Our speaker today will be Jesus Jimenez. He is here at the school with his wife Carmen. Back home he has two sons, Jesus and David, and one daughter, Alejandra. He has one grandchild, Martin. He comes from Monterrey, Mexico. He has preached for 11 years before coming to the Memphis School of Preaching, and he has been an instructor in the Monterey School of Preaching. He'll be speaking today on laying foundations overseas. Come and speak to us, brother.
If we want to restore the New Testament foundation of the church, we should need to restore the overseas evangelistic foundation of the New Testament church. The restoration movement has made a great job in this country, bringing back to the Bible and to the true gospel of Christ many people. And some of them also has done a great job bringing the pure gospel of Christ around so many countries around this world. In my personal case, I thank God that my country is one of those where the New Testament Christianity, the New Testament Church, has been established. But the question is, what is the overseas evangelistic work that our congregations are doing today? There are more than 7 billion of people in this world. And how many of them know about Jesus Christ? How many of them know about the gospel, the true gospel of Jesus Christ? And how many of them know about the New Testament church? They are in great necessity to know the good news of salvation in order to save their souls, because most of them are under the darkness of sin in this world. Most of them also have been deceived by so many false teaching and teachers. And also most of them, and this is the most hard thing, most of them are passing to the eternity without Christ and without hope for their souls. Those who became the restoration movement gave the idea that in evangelistic matters, there is a foundation which has been established by the New Testament. They believe that bring the gospel overseas is the responsibility that the church has today. And it is because it's a commandment of our Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, because is the apostolic practice, and also number three, because it is the example of the New Testament church. Let us consider the commandment of Jesus Christ. I want to say that the perspective of Jesus Christ about evangelism concerning the people or individuals for his kingdom is overseas. He said, even when during his ministry, he commanded his disciples to preach the gospel, to preach the word just to the Jewish people. After his death and resurrection, he commanded to his apostles to preach the gospel to every kind of people in this world. Jesus said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, and he that believeth not shall be damned." So in the mind of Christ was the idea that the gospel is for all kind of people in this world. Since the greatest problem of men is the sin, and all of men are under sin, so people need to know about Jesus Christ, because Christ is the Lamb of God which takes away the sin of the world. And all the people is under sin in this world. They need to know about Jesus Christ. They need to know about the Word of God, because the Word of God is able to save their souls, James 1:21. So the vision of Jesus Christ, the concept of Jesus Christ concerning people, is that all kind of people in this world know about his gospel. But also, I want to say that the perspective of Jesus Christ about evangelism concerning the territory for his kingdom is also overseas. When before his ascension, to heaven, he commands his apostles that they will be his witnesses till the uttermost part of the earth. Not just Jerusalem, not just Judea and Samaria, but also uttermost part of the earth. The territory for the kingdom of God includes all the countries of this world. Not just one country, but all the countries of this world. So, in the mind of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, is the idea that the gospel will be preached not only in one particular kind of people, not only in one particular country, but in all the world. Think for a moment in Abraham's promise. God said to Abraham, "In thy seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed." But how can all the families of the earth be blessed if we are not preaching the word around the world? The teaching of the Old Testament prophets said same thing. Isaiah said, for example, that the gospel is for all nations. Isaiah 2:2-3 says, "And all nations will flow unto the mountain of the Lord," which is the church. But how can people from all nations come unto the church if we are not preaching the word? So the commandment of Jesus Christ is clear for us. We need to preach the gospel to every kind of people and in every country around this world. Because the concept for evangelism of our Lord Jesus Christ is an overseas concept for preach the word. But we need to bring the gospel overseas, not just because it's a commandment of Jesus Christ, but also because it is the apostolic practice. We don't have enough time to say all that the book of Acts says about the work of the apostles overseas. But keep in mind, Peter, even when he was in Jerusalem for some years at the beginning of the church, but after the chapter 8 of the book of Acts, Peter is found preaching the gospel outside of Jerusalem. He went to Samaria together with John, and they went there because they need to give the Holy Spirit to the Samaritans, those who Philip have preached the gospel. But after that, they went to all the cities of the Samaritans preaching the word, according with Acts 8:14-26. Peter also was going to the cities of Judea and Galilee and Samaria in chapter 9 of the book of Acts. And by this time, he went to Lydda, and by the healing of Aeneas, many people from Lydda and Sharon obeyed the gospel. Also, he went to Joppa, and after the resurrection of Dorcas, he was called by the Holy Spirit to bring the gospel into Cornelius' house in Caesarea Maritima. And Peter showed his great concern for the overseas church when he wrote his two epistles, which was addressed for those brothers who were in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. 1 Peter 1:1 and 2 Peter 3:1. Also John did great job together with Peter. He went with Peter to Samaria and all the cities of the Samaritans. But I believe the great example of this is the Apostle Paul. We know that he was called by the Lord when he was on a way to Damascus. And after he obeyed the gospel in Damascus, he immediately started to preach the gospel in this city. He was in Damascus for a time, and then he went to Arabia, and he came back to Damascus and preached the gospel in the synagogues of the Jews. And after that, he went to Jerusalem and tried to work together with the apostle in this place, but the Lord commanded him to leave Jerusalem and go to Tarsus, his own city, and he was working there. And when the church was established in Antioch of Syria, and Barnabas was there. Barnabas brought him from Tarsus, and both were working together in Antioch of Syria for 1 year, till the Holy Spirit called them to begin the first missionary journey. And from this city, Paul did 3 missionary journeys. In the first missionary journey, Luke made mention about 10 regions, countries, and cities where Paul and Barnabas were preaching the word. And in the second missionary journey were 17 places. And in third missionary journey, 12 places are mentioned in the book of Acts. Therefore, the apostolic practice was overseas, because they believe that there is a world which is sunken in deep darkness of sin. They believe that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, Romans 1:16. They believe that the gospel is the only way to be justified by God of our sins, Romans 5:1. And they believe that Christ is the only way by which the people can fix his life, John 14:6. So we need to bring the gospel overseas, not just because it's a commandment of the Lord and because it's the apostolic practice, but also because it is the example of the New Testament church. We don't have enough time to talk about all the work that they did in first century. But think about those who were scattered abroad after Stephen's death, those who were from Jerusalem. The Bible said that they were in the regions of Judea and Samaria preaching the word, and notice that, everywhere. Acts 8:4. And the Bible says, the Bible given us one example of this. Philip went to Samaria, and he was preaching Christ unto Samaritans, Acts 8, verse 5. But after that, Philip also was sent by an angel to preach the gospel unto the Ethiopian at the way from Jerusalem unto Gaza, Acts 8, 25 and 26. And after that, Philip was at Azotus, and passing, he was preaching in all the cities of this region, Acts 8, 40. And finally, he came to Caesarea Maritima, and probably he established the church in this place, Acts 8, 40 and 18, 22. Think about also Barnabas, who was a missionary brother from the church at Jerusalem. He was sent to Antioch of Syria to see and exhort the young church, which had been recently established, to keep their faithfulness unto the Lord in Acts 11, 22 and 23. But also, think about the example of the church in Antioch of Syria. They sent relief to the church in Judea as part of his missionary job. And they were able, guided by the Holy Spirit, to organize 3 missionary journeys of Paul. And probably they support the missionary journey of Barnabas and John Mark when they went to Cyprus to preach the word, Acts 16:39. What about the example of the church at Thessalonica? Paul said that from they sounded out the word of the Lord in Macedonia, in Achaia, and in every place. Notice that, in every place. Acts 1 Thessalonians 1:8. And they brought the gospel to the region till the point that Paul did not need to preach there anymore. This kind of job this brother of Thessalonica did. The question is, what is the work that we are doing today? Is it like Thessalonica brothers? What about the example of the church of Philippi? This church, the church at Philippi, support the missionary work of Paul. They send support him. No one time, but several times they did it. according to Philippians 4:15-16. And they also sent Epaphroditus to help Paul when he was in the prison in Rome. Epaphroditus was the minister of the needs of Paul at prison in this time. Brother and sister, all of this is missionary job. It's an overseas vision of the church. It's an overseas work that we need to do in our times. Because outside of the church, there is a world which is perishing in the sins. The first century church set an overseas foundation for evangelism because they learned to see the people of this world in their real spiritual state. They see the people lost in sin, sunken in deep spiritual need, looking for light in midst of the darkness of one sinful life, without God in this world, without Christ and without hope of salvation, and gone straight to hell. That is the way that we need to see the people in this world. Outside of this country, there are countries where they know nothing about the gospel of Christ. And you know what is the end of them? Hell is expecting for them. So we need to understand that, like Jesus Christ saw the people as sheep without pastor and felt compassion for them, we also need feel compassion for those who are in sin around this world. I want to finish saying that if we want to continue making the restoration of the New Testament Christianity, we have to return also to the overseas evangelistic foundation of the New Testament. We cannot hear about it and close our Bibles and go home. We cannot hear this thing and just take a place in a pew every Sunday and sing, "I want to be a worker for the Lord." We cannot do that. We must go outside of the church building and bring the gospel to those who are lost. I want to encourage you, elders, deacons, preachers, teachers, and membership, to be involved in missionary field. This is the greatest task of the church today, because there is a world which is hungry for the true word of God. A world which is perishing in sin, without Christ, without hope for the eternity. Thank you.
I need a plane ticket. I need to go. I don't know if you have observed something this week. I hope you have. We had a medical doctor, student at the Memphis School of Preaching, speak to us Monday. We had an African American student at the Memphis School of Preaching speak to us Tuesday. We had a man suffering from multiple sclerosis speak to us yesterday. And today, a man from Mexico. The world has been coming to us in recent years. What Jesus was trying to tell us is, let's go back and teach them the gospel. That is our belief here. We don't believe that the United States is the only place the gospel should be preached. We believe in missions. We believe that if God will let us do it, if God will bless us in doing it, we're going to invite men from all over this world to come here and study with us and then go back to where they were and start those congregations. Jesus intends to go back to Monterey. I believe he will be a teacher there again. What a great privilege it's been for me to be involved in these lives. And so in that sense, something wonderful is being given us here at Memphis that we've not seen before. The world is coming here now, and we are going to be, with God's help, sending all of us back out there. I know we can tell a lot of bad things about this country, but a lot of bad things are all over the world too. But we are the salt and the light, brothers and sisters, and we are the only hope of the world. If we don't tell them, who will? And so I want everyone to leave this lectureship this year with his head up, no buttons on his coat, and I want him to be proud of the fact that he's a member of the Lord's church, the Church of Christ. The only group of saved people on the face of this earth, read your Bible. And so we are blessed with these men. It's a privilege for me to be involved in their lives in any way. Even though I have to give them tests, some of them still say, well, he's all right. But I'm blessed to be with these men in their lives. And I'm hoping these first-year guys will perk up now and see what it's all about. It's not about us. It's about his work and giving glory to Christ. We have a song, and you'll be dismissed for a few minutes, and we'll start the session at 9 o'clock. Thank you very much for helping us and encouraging us this morning.